My dear brothers and sisters, we are going to take a quick look. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to take a quick look at Hebrew chapter 11, verse 32 to 35. Hebrew chapter number 11, verse 32 through 35. Thank you, Jesus. For us who read, may your Holy Spirit open our inner faculty to understand you divinely. In Jesus' name, amen. And what more shall I say? For time will fail me if I tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David, and Samuel, and the prophets, who by faith conquered kingdoms, performed acts of righteousness, obtained promises, shut the mouths of the lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. From weakness they were made strong, became mighty in war, put sovereign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. And others were tortured, not accepting their release, so that they might obtain a better resurrection. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to you, O God. My dear brothers and sisters, we have just read Hebrews chapter 11, verse 32 to 35. That 11th chapter of Hebrews has been popularly known as the chapter of faith, or the heroes of faith. And we see the Holy Spirit testifying to the ministry of the prophets. Moses, prophets like Gideon, like Barak and Samson and Jephthah, like Samuel, David, and so on and so forth. The name continues, and the Holy Spirit was behind the extraordinary things that God used their ministries to do or to accomplish when these men were on earth. God used them to do and accomplish things recorded as impossible, to achieve things known to be impossible. God used them to challenge the culture of the time, to challenge the system of things in their own time. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, God talked about a man like David. God used David to conquer Goliath. God talked about a man like Samuel that was so much devoted to the love of God that he was living life even in the synagogue, in the house of God, leading the people with the fear of God. The Bible talks about a man like Samson who killed a lion. I mean, have you ever thought about somebody killing a lion? The Bible did not even tell us that Samson killed a lion with a gun or machine gun. No, with bare hand. I mean, I don't know how many of us that can even kill a lion with a gun. The fear of lion alone is enough to tremble for the person to be in a state of fear, that even the gun may even drop from your hand. But Samson killed the lion with bare hand. My dear brothers and sisters, these men of faith, God used them to change what has been widely accepted by the society. It has been accepted that no one would kill Goliath.
A whole nation accepted that fact. Saul was in the palace, trembling, not even coming out to come and challenge Goliath. The armies of Israel were in the valley, shaking. No one could come to confront or challenge Goliath. They all accepted the fact that anytime Goliath was in the front of the Philistines, that the Philistines will win the battle. If the Israelites had known and convinced themselves that they would conquer, even though the Goliath was there, they would have been there in the valley hiding. They would have come out and challenged that uncircumcised Philistine, otherwise called Goliath. But David said, I know the God who saved me from the mouth of the lions. I have killed lions. I have killed the bears. I have taken the sheep out of the mouth of the lion. And he knew that God would see him through, even the time of trouble, even the time that Goliath was raging. So David now went ahead to confront Goliath. So many voices were telling Goliath, what were telling David, do you really know what you are doing? Are you out of your mind? A voice was telling him that he will not make it. Lots of people were telling him, don't go into this war. Don't go and fight this man. But David knew that God was with him. And we know the rest of the story. How the God of David used David to destroy Goliath. If David had accepted what was accepted by the whole nation, that Goliath could never be destroyed, do you think he would have destroyed Goliath? Of course, no. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, do you think that Samson would have been able to destroy a lion if he had accepted the fact that no one would kill a lion with a bare hand? Do you think he would have had the guts to go and confront that lion? The Bible says in the Hebrews chapter 11 that we just read, especially in verse 33, that he shot the mouth of the lions, not just one lion, the mouths, plural, of the lions with a bare hand. He refused the fact that the society had accepted the fact that no one would kill a lion with a bare hand. So with Queen Esther, it had been accepted that no one would go to the king without being invited by the king. But the queen went to the king with God. She went into prayers after fasting 3 days and three nights, eating no food, drinking no water, and then at the end, she went to the king, and she got the favor. My dear brothers and sisters, God used these men to challenge the acceptable norm of the society. Many a time, we accept the message of the society. We accept the things the society has handed over to us. And we seem to be living in that, in the envelope, in the template of the society. The society will make a template that no one can make it who comes from this nationality, or who comes with this complexion, or who has this ethnicity. And many people accept that. My dear brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit is here to tell us that such acceptance of the template of the society should be rejected. And God started administering to us about this message by telling us about men like Gideon, men like Barak, men like Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and so on and so forth. By the way, we know about the story of Gideon. Gideon, like many of us, doubted his abilities. He accepted the fact that he was a small boy. He accepted the fact that there was nothing that he could be good for. In fact, when God was calling him, God called him in Judges chapter 3, verse 12 and said, great warrior. Can you imagine somebody that God will call a great warrior? And the Bible said, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Gideon, I could imagine Gideon turning around wondering whether the angel was referring to some other person. But the angel told him, Gideon, I'm talking to you. Me? I don't know what is that to tell the angel. He said, look, I am the least in my tribe. In fact, I am the least in my family. My family is the least in my kindred. My kindred is the least in my tribe. And my tribe is the least in Israel. He was documenting, oh my goodness, the template of the site about his life. He was releasing the negativities about his life. And he accepted it, and he was living under it. And he was living life as a peasant farmer. So Gideon was seeing himself as a peasant farmer, as a small boy, as somebody who could not do anything good, as somebody who cannot amount to anything good, as somebody who will never be a great man. But God was seeing him differently. God was calling him a great warrior. And that was the way the angel greeted him. Mighty warrior, the Lord is with you. He was even wondering, how could the Lord be with me? And my people are suffering. He doubted the angel. Gideon doubted his own abilities. He accepted what the society had handed over to him. And he grew up with that mentality. And so he suffered so many defeats and so many failures to the point that he even put God to the test. Not once, but three times. The Bible introduced Gideon as a man threshing grain in the winepress. Threshing grain. You know what that means, right? This is not just that he was a farmer, but he was the least, the one doing the part of the farming activity that demands so much energy, so much labor. You know, he was a laborer in the farm. Threshing. People will harvest the grain plants. He will gather them and start threshing them. Threshing requires a lot of muscle. And he was threshing the grain in the wine press. From morning till night, he goes back to the bed. He will collapse on the bed and start sleeping. Early in the morning, he gets up. That is his life. This is what I've been doing. Job reserved for non-entities, because he accepted that is where he belonged. But when the angel saw that this man was walking where he does not belong to, he now came in the name of the Lord and said, mighty man of valor, the Lord is with you. My dear brothers and sisters, I want to let you know that the moment Gideon accepted who actually he was before God, then God now started to glorify himself in the life of Gideon. Are you like Gideon? Doubting your abilities? Accepting the fact that you're the least. Accepting the fact that because you are a foreigner in another country, then you cannot do certain jobs. That you will always do the least of the jobs. That you will always be a cleaner. Is that what you are meant to understand? Is that what the society passes as a message to you? I am here to tell you to reject it. That the God of Gideon, who told Gideon in Judges chapter 3, verse 12, that the Lord is with you, mighty warrior, telling him that this is your true identity, to be a leader of the people of Israel. That God is also talking to somebody tonight.
Many of us are mighty warriors. But we are just living our lives in shadow. All this time, Gideon was living his life in shadow. But when he answered his call of God, when he discovered his true identity, then he recovered his dignity. And now he now became a leader. One of the leaders in Israel was Gideon, a great warrior. But he didn't know he was a mighty man, because he accepted the template of the society. My dear brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit is inviting us to review the things in our lives that we have accepted as a norm. Things we have accepted that this is the way it should be because of certain characteristics of our lives. Perhaps where we come from. Perhaps our complexion or ethnicity. Or perhaps the church you belong to. Or perhaps the ministry you belong to. Jesus. So many of these templates are there. And people have been accepting it from time to time and all the time. My dear brothers and sisters, I am here to tell you that it's time for us to claim what God has kept for us. That God is here to talk to us. That God is here to invite us to call on His name. That He will change all things. That He will bring us to our dignity. He will restore the dignity of His children. Jesus. And so, my brothers and sisters, if I may ask you a question, what are the things in your life that you have accepted just because the society says this is what it is? Things we have accepted like Gideon. What are those things? For example, the society believes that when one gets older, you know, one's health begins to deteriorate. And then the person will begin to have a poor health. This is an accepted norm. This is, you know, nobody teaches all this directly. But indirectly, this is the way the society sees life. We think that when we get older, we have to be in poor health. That's what the society thinks. The society thinks that when we get older, then we'll start having diseases. Then we'll start having arthritis, diabetes, rheumatism, and so on and so forth. Then we'll start living in the hospital. Then we become unemployable. And then nobody wants to employ us. Nobody wants to employ the old. Is that the template in your mind? Then you see the aged taking a low-paying job. You see the template of society portraying that the old will become depressed or sad or lonely or financially in need or dependent all the time. Or driving old car with perhaps with 300,000 miles on it. We could go on and on. Brothers and sisters, we have a tendency to accept these things. We think certain things about ourselves that goes contrary to what God says about ourselves. And because we accept these things, we give the enemy the opportunities to begin to deal with us, to torment us. My brothers and sisters, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7, that as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Be careful with what goes on in your mind, with the things you accept. If you accept what the society has handed over to you, then like Gideon, you will be a laborer where you're supposed to be a leader, a king, where you're supposed to be a mighty warrior. Jesus. God is talking to us this wonderful night. What are the things going on in your mind? Hell. Jesus.
The society believes that at old age, that you cannot do anything good, that you are just there, winding away time. But do you know one thing? The Bible tells us in Psalm 71, verse 18 to 19, now that I am old and my hair is gray, don't leave me, God. I must tell the next generation about your power and greatness. Exodus 7, verse 69 says, so Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord had commanded them. Moses was 8 years old, and Aaron was 83 when they made their demands to Pharaoh. Wow. They were old men. Can you imagine 80 and 83 years? Moses was 80. Aaron was 83 years. That was the time. That was their age when God told them to go to the house of Pharaoh. God used them to deliver a whole nation from the hands of Pharaoh at that age. God did not say, oh, because of your age, I cannot use you. No. There is nothing God cannot do. Genesis chapter 21, verse 1 to 3 says, now the Lord was gracious to Sarah, as he had said. And the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age. That's the Bible talking. That's the word of God. That is God telling us to believe the account of the Holy Spirit. Whose account are you taking, brother? Ever since you went to the doctor, and you have been told that, oh, at your age, this is what you have to accept. I have seen people who said, no, I'm not going to accept it. I was talking with a woman last week, and she told me something that marveled me. Her husband, you know, just died. Somebody that had nothing doing to her husband, everything was normal. They were talking. He was never sick. He was not sick. They said that the husband just collapsed. By the time she called the 911 on their way, there were some delays. And then by the time they were coming, the man had passed, you know, out. And then by the time they went to the hospital, he was pronounced dead, clinically dead, confirmed dead. And this man said, no. How can somebody, my own husband, I was talking with just a couple of hours ago, you're telling me that he's dead? He said, no way, I'm not accepting it. Then he went on her ground, on her knees, and was pounding prayer, praying day and night for the whole day. The next day again, for 3 days, she was pounding prayers, praying her rosary, calling on God. Say, God, I am not accepting this template. I'm not accepting this debt. And she continued to make the prayer. People were coming, telling her, ma'am, you are wasting your time. Ma'am, sorry that this happened, but you know what? He is already decaying. What this woman was saying, the husband was a decaying man. She told me that on the fourth day, this man came back to life and went into a state of coma. Doctors were surprised. What did you do? And she said, I am just calling on my God. My dear brothers and sisters, it is time for us to reject what the society has made us to accept. What the hospital has made us to accept. I'm not saying that doctors are not doing their job. They can tell you what is clinically wrong. But you have the right, as a child of God, to say, no, I know that God is my healer. I know that God touched Sarah and restored her fertility. And therefore, I have my own children, even at this age. I believe that God will do it for me. Jesus. I know that in Psalm 107, verse 20, that God spoke his word and he healed them. I know that he will heal me. I know that my situation will change. I'm not accepting this situation. Oh, yes.
Jesus.
God will restore you. God will renew you. He will renew your life. Even at old age. Even at the time people are expecting you to yield and collapse. And be at the mercy of the society. Be at the mercy of people. There, even then, you'll be strong. Ruth, chapter 4, verse 15 says, He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. Can you imagine that? That at old age, God is sustaining you. That is, old age wouldn't be a burden or a barrier. But when you accept the fact that at old age, I will be crippled on the ground, or at the old age, I have nothing to offer again. I'm just decaying. I become vegetable. No way! Who told you that? The Bible says that He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. Isaiah chapter 46 verse 4 says, And I will still be carrying you when you are old. When your hair will turn gray, I will still carry you. You know who we're talking about? God. I will carry you. That same God I've been carrying you when you were a baby. He's telling us even when you grow gray-headed, that He will still carry you. He will sustain you. He will restore you. He will help you. In fact, in Psalm 71 verse 9, the Bible says, And now, in my old age, don't set me aside. Don't forsake me now when my strength is failing. Jesus. So whose account are you believing, brother? It's not an account that once your husband is dead, then the relative will come and take all the investments made. Is that the account? Is that the account that when your children start getting married, then you become lonely? No way! Jesus. Whose account? God is talking to us this night. Jesus. The Bible says in Proverbs 23 verse 7, As a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. So is he. What goes on in your heart? What is the transaction in your heart? What are the things you have accepted? Because the society has made you to accept so. Or the society is suggesting that you accept so. Some people say, that's just the way I am. You know, my great-grandfather, you know, I knew him. He died by this disease. My father died by this disease. And you know what? So I'm just having it. It's okay. Who told you it's okay? I was talking with somebody late last year in a park where I took my children to go and play. You know, so I was there and I was talking with one man. He said, I have a cancer. And you know what, I'm just 60 years. That's fine. You know, that's a good number. I started looking at him. 60 years is a good number. He had already accepted it that way. He had accepted the fact he was waiting for his death. Jesus. Brother, how do you think? The Bible says that as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So is he. Jesus. Huh? God is talking to us tonight. Some people say, usually this season of the year, you know, yeah, that's okay. I start having some sickness usually at this part of the year. The pollen grain, the pollen is in the air. The air is polluted. And you accept that this is the norm. Who told you that it should be so? It shouldn't be so. It could have been otherwise. But because you accepted it like Gideon, you started to be at the mercy of the enemy. Many people are operating at a level they're not supposed to be in life because they've accepted the norm. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, there's no need for tears. God says, I wipe your tears. Yes, the media may be telling us stories like, oh, people are losing their, the economy is very bad, everybody is losing their job. And then you say, well, that's okay, I know I lost my job because the economy is bad. It could have been otherwise. When we accept these things, the enemy takes root. The enemy takes advantage. The enemy wants to act on our ignorance. On the things we accept, the enemy amplifies his attack. Many of the things we pass through today, we suffer today, many of them are just because of the fact that we have invariably said yes, either directly or indirectly. You might say, oh, life is hard these days, you know what? I've had it rough. That's okay. You know, my father had it, my grandmother had it. Everybody is losing their job. Things are just going the way it's going. Don't think so. I listened to a preacher one day who talked about a lady in England, you know, whose great grandmother died of breast cancer. Grandmother died of breast cancer. Her own mother died of breast cancer. Now she has already had breast cancer, and then she just concluded, okay, since these cancers are always coming to the breast, that means that this is normal, this is okay in our lineage. And then she just went and had a surgery and cut off her left breast. When the cancer came, cancer went to the lung. And it is displeasing when people act because the society, because the message of the enemy appear to have facts. There is no fact that will come from the lips of the devil. Everything from the lips of the devil are all lies, deceit. All right? She accepted that and she had a surgery. But when the cancer came, cancer went to the lungs. I know what? She died. As a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. My dear brothers and sisters, that cancer that came to that lady was her own Goliath. And I tell you, that was the same Goliath that came to David. But David said, you know what? I refuse to accept the fact that my people, the whole nation, are running away, hiding, and accepting that Goliath would defeat the nation. And he went and confronted that Goliath with the word of God. Say, Goliath, you come against me with your military strength, but I come against you with the word of God. This war is between you and my God, the God of Israel. Wow. How many times have you told that situation you are passing through? You know what? This war is between you and my God, and you can't conquer my God. You are not bigger than my God. Have you ever told that problem, that kind of stuff? You see, these problems, these spirits, these afflictions, they have ears. And when you speak the word of God, they listen to you. Jesus. So there is no need for tears in your eyes. It is time to use the word of God, claim the word of God, and use it to confront the enemy. Jesus confronted the enemy in Luke chapter 4 while he was in the desert by using the word of God. It is written. How many times have you told the enemy it is written? Jesus told the enemy, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, by the word of God. How many times have you told the enemy, it is written in Psalm 118 verse 17, I shall not die, I shall live to testify the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. How many times have you told the enemy, look, you will not see my end, I will see your end. How many times have you told the enemy, you know what, you're wasting your time. This storm will not carry me. Have you told him of Isaiah chapter 43 verse 2 that what God says that even though I pass through the waters, I shall not be drowned. Even though I pass through the fire, I shall not be scorched. You know what? You spirit that is causing me problems in my family, causing me problems in my health, causing me afflictions in my business, you are just a transient. You cannot last long. Even though you are tormenting me now, even though you are harassing me now, but I know you will not live long. Because I know that my God
will vindicate me. Have you told that situation, that type of thing?
Jesus said, John 10, verse 10, I am come, that ye may have life more abundantly.
Or life to the full. Oh, yes. Jesus. I was listening to somebody, you know, talking some few days ago, and he said that he started having high blood pressure, and he went into prayers. He started praying. He said as he was praying, God opened his eyes, and he saw a spirit like something like a monkey sitting on a certain part of the naval communication between the heart and between the heart and the brain. And that spirit was just in between. And he now said, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you be destroyed. After making that prayer, he said, that spirit left, and the high blood pressure came down. His blood pressure restored. If he had accepted the fact, okay, I'm a black man, you know what, history shows, it has been shown historically that, you know, black races have high blood pressure, then he would have been living with it. Because the society has said that this has been proven fact in the laboratory. This has been proven fact statistically. And then you accept it. When you have the word of God, you can create the world around you. You can control this around you. Jesus.
The Bible tells us in Psalm 91 verse 16, I will satisfy him with a long life and show him my salvation. That is God.
Yeah, Jesus.
The Lord says, I am the Lord that healeth thee. Have you taken and claimed the power of healing? Have you used the word of God to challenge that situation?
Somebody say, but I'm not healed. I'm just taking my drugs. I'm just on my...
You can use the word of God as your prescription. You can use the word of God as your tablets, as your own medication. You can speak the word of God, and this will happen. The fact that you are praying and the symptoms of that thing that is still there does not mean that that thing is still alive. A tree could be dead, but the tree is still standing. Remember that when Jesus caused the fig tree was still standing. It was the next day that Jesus and his disciples were passing by the same way, and Peter pointed, noted the fact that that tree had dried. Even though you are making a prayer, I say, I know that this is my portion. I know that this sickness is not for me. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. I'm not a temple of sickness. And after making that prayer, and you still see it, the symptoms, I want to let you know that even though you still see the symptoms, it is not a fact that it is there. It is in the drying season. Like the fig tree, it is drying. The fig tree took time to dry. It didn't dry immediately. The eyes didn't see it drying out immediately. But in the spirit, it was dried up. Life had gone out.
Jesus.
Brother, God is talking to us. He wants us to take the word of God seriously. Use the word of God to make the enemy to flee from you. Resist the enemy with the word of God.
James 4 verse 7 says, resist him and he will flee.
Do you want the enemy to flee? Do you want that sickness to flee? Do you want that near success syndrome to flee? Then take the word of God. When enemy tells you you're wasting your time, you're not healed, tell him that I'm healed. Period. Tell him you are healed. I am healed. Yes, Lord. The healing comes in the spirit. and works its way to the physical. It starts from the spirit and ends up in the physical. That's how it goes. Even when you go and kill a tree, you know, maybe you cut off the roots and the tree is still there, don't bother. Watch it over time, you see it dry up. From the invisible, it comes to visibility. Jesus. God is talking to us. That change you're expecting will happen in the name of Jesus. That wind of change will blow in the name of Jesus. We have got to shatter the image of sickness and disease and lack and poverty and replace it with a concept of God's provisions for us. God got a provision for you. I tell you the truth. Jesus. The Bible went to us and God renews our minds. He renews our minds. Do you want your minds to be renewed? Your mind to be renewed? Then go to the Lord. He will renew your mind. Remember 2 Corinthians 4 verse 16? And God, the Bible says, even though our mortal bodies are wasting away, yet inwardly we are renewed in the spirit. The renewal takes place in the spirit and works its way towards the physical. Jesus. So let us reject this fact that this is the way it is. Let us reject the fact in our mindset that this is the way things have to be. The way the people say it. The way the society says it. The way the media says it. No way. In fact, Romans 12, 2 tells us, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. Begin to believe the promises of God in your life. Begin to believe the promise of God has actually been fulfilled in your life. This requires faith. In fact, you cannot please God without faith. Hebrews 11 verse 6 tells us, no one can please God without faith. No one. No one. You cannot move the mountain without faith. You cannot challenge the devil without faith. You cannot recreate your situations without faith. You need faith, brother. When you have that vision of faith in your life, then you cannot perish. You will have breakthrough. You will control the situation because the power of God will make it to come to reality. Remember Proverbs chapter 29, verse 18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Reprogram your vision. Bias your life with faith. Reprogram your life with faith. Begin to see yourself in a different way. I mean, this was what God was telling Gideon. He said, Gideon, stop seeing yourself as a mediocre. Stop seeing yourself as a failure. Stop seeing yourself as a sick man, as a sick woman. Begin to see yourself as a mighty warrior. Many people accept the fact that God is no more with them. And I meet them all the time. A few days ago, a sister was telling me, brother, you know what? I think God is not with me. He's no more with me because, I mean, the things I go through show that God is not with me. I told her, no, don't think that way, sister. God is with you. Even that trouble, God is with you. He loves you. His name is love. Jesus. I've lived my life teaching students mathematics, and I think it makes sense to say that God is equal to love squared. You know, just as a way of portraying the fact that the love of God is great. I mean, love, rest upon infinity, is actually the better way to put it, because your love has no limit. Begin to see yourself in a different way from today. This is the challenge
God is ministering to us today. Begin to see yourself in a different way. In fact, this is the title of this talk. From today, I see myself in a different way. That's the title of this talk. This title of this talk is an invitation for all of us to start to use the Word of God to touch our lives, to see our ways, our lives a different way. See yourself as a generous giver instead of always receiving. See yourself as somebody that can pray for somebody, not somebody who will always be prayed upon. It doesn't please me, and I say with all sincerity, that every time people are calling me, pray for me, pray for me. I want to, my dream about the prayer line, my prayer, and God is my witness, is to have everybody in the prayer line becoming firebrand prayer warriors. People who understand the scripture. People who use the word of God to pray themselves to breakthrough. There was one night we had one of our prayers, and a sister told me that, you know what, brother, after the prayer, somebody called me and said, oh, brother, sister, I'm sick. I'm very sick. Please, what do I do? And she wanted to connect the sister to Brother Wahwe. And she said, oh, Brother Wahwe will not be happy if after this prayer, I'm sick, I'm connecting somebody to pray for this woman. You know, Brother Wahwe will expect me to pray, having received the word of God. And then she said, you know what? I would have connected to one brother, Brother Wahwe, but you know, let me pray for you. And then she said that she started to pray and say, call on the Lord. And you know what? That sister got healed. Not afterwards, that night, as the prayer was going on, healing took place. Hallelujah. That is the generation I'm looking at. That is my vision about the prayer line. People who will take the word of God, drink the word of God, eat the word of God, digest the word of God, ruminate the word of God, and assimilate the word of God, and in fact, live the word of God. Then Satan will see them and run. At that point, your blood will become too hot for the witches to drink. They may have been drinking your blood. You wake up from bed, blood everywhere on the bed, because they have scratched you a lot. They want suya meat. They come and take some meat from your body. But when you become too hot, they can't eat you. Who can eat a meat from a boiling water? I mean, no one. My brothers and sisters, it is time to use the power that God has put into our tongues to speak into that Goliath, to speak into those lions, to speak into those mountains, and in the name of Jesus, they will begin to melt by fire. In the name of Jesus, begin to speak into that situation, and they will begin to melt. For the Bible says in Psalm 68, verse 2, that before the praise of the Lord, the water, even the wax, will melt. They will melt. The wax will melt before the praise of the Lord. Psalm 114 verse 7 says, before the praise of the Lord, the earth will tremble. Verse 8 says, and even the rocks will turn into a pond. That rock will melt. That mountain will melt at the praise of the Lord. Use your tongue, and you see the difference from today. Proverbs chapter 18 verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and the dead that love it eat the fruit thereof. So if you say, I am sick and I'm tired, I am unemployable, and you are looking for something to have pity on you, hey, the devil will just start eating food. The devil will start rejoicing because you have accepted sickness. You have accepted, you know, to be tired in life. So if you say, I am tired, then you get it. This is not my wish for you, but this is what it is in the spiritual realm. And we need to face the fact tonight. I'm poor. You know, nobody in my family makes it. I think it's okay. Nobody I've ever met in my family. Okay. You accepted that.
then you will surely get it. But when you say, you know what, even though this has been this way in my lineage, even though it has been this way in my life, but from today, not in my own time, I say no way. Yeah. Then the devil will know that you mean business. Oh, why not say, I am the righteousness of God? Why not say, I am a person of faith? Why not say, I am a conqueror? I will never be a victim of the devil. When you speak those words, things happen. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony. You have to overcome the enemy by the word of God, by the blood of the Lamb. Abraham was a person that God gave many promises. Yes, God gave many promises to him. But you know what? They were thin promises, not the reality. All the time that even when he was 70, it was thin promises. 70 years old, promises. 80 years old, promises. 90 years old, promises. It was when he was about 100 that the promises came to fulfillment. Isaac came in. By that time, Sarah was already about 90. Maybe as you are hearing my voice now, you are still remembering the promises God has given to you, but it hasn't come to fulfillment. Wait for it. Speak life into that garden. Water that garden with the word of God. You will reap the dividends. Romans chapter 4, verse 16 and following, it says that Abraham called those things that be not as though they were. That was calling them by his faith. He was calling those things that were not as if they were. I hope it makes sense, right? Clinically, there are no reason why you will ever conceive. But you are claiming, calling those children into your womb as if they were. That is the realm of faith. That was what Abraham was doing. And that was what earned him the title, the man of faith. When we sing this song that says, Abraham, blessings are mine. Abraham, blessings are mine. I am blessed in the morning. I am blessed in the night. Abraham, blessings. Let me tell you something. It was somebody's faith you were tapping into. You were resounding. But your own faith needs to be resounded. What is your faith? Your husband is sick, lying on the bed. Doctors have given their verdict. Use the word of God and things will happen. Sometimes we are going through a time when things are not like we want them to be. You know, things don't have to be like that. Better say that way. Maybe you are struggling now, and maybe you have been struggling all this while. But that does not justify the fact that it has to be accepted to be that way forever. Mm-mm. You may be in your silent time now. You may be in your wilderness now, but God is coming to water your garden. Abraham called those things that be not as though they were. He released his faith through the word of God. Words bring things from the realm of unreality into the realm of the reality. I repeat, listen carefully. The word of God, the word you release, whatever thing that cometh out of your mouth, brings things from the realm of the unreality, from the realm of the invisible, into the realm of the reality. How do we know this? Because the Bible says so. In the beginning, God said, let there be light, And the light came. And so on and so forth. Can you say, let there be good health? Can you say, let there be long life? Can you say, let there be powerful relationship with God? Can you say, let there be born again? Can you say, let there be righteousness in the land, in my life, in my family? Can you say, let there be peace? Can you say that? I like what the lions do in the morning. In the morning, lions wake up and I could imagine lions stretching themselves and the lion has woken up this morning. Looking around, all the animals in the jungle will run just because the lion has woken up. The lion announces to the day, say, oh, as the sun is rising from the east, I am rising into strength. Can a child of God do that? Tomorrow we are waking up from the bed and you're going to the mirror looking at yourself and say, what? You are going to go to places today. You are going to meet amazing people today. You are going to meet opportunities today. You are going to win a soul for Christ today. You are going to meet blessings today. Blessings will locate me today. My feet will be guided by the Holy Spirit today. Hey, I'm going to receive favor in my office today. I will not struggle in the things I will do today. Then you are programming the day. That's how to program the day. You program the day that way. All right? You decree that the devil has no plan power over me. Amen? Words are creative. Words are creative. Whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou moved and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt his heart, but shall believe that those things shall come to pass, he shall have whatever he said. Mark chapter 11:23. I wonder why that mountain is still there. Because you have not spoken the word. You have not spoken the word. I wonder why he talks about the mountain. A mountain is a very big thing. It is a big problem. But that problem with God, by the power of the word of God, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord, I pray over you now. Every mountain that says you cannot cross over, mountain that are saying that they are uncrossable, I declare them melting in the name of Jesus. May the power of God begin to touch you now in the name of Jesus. I minister the healing power of God. I minister the mercy of God upon you right now in the name of Jesus. May the God Almighty begin to touch everyone that is sick now. We command that sickness right now begin to come out anywhere you are. By the power of the word of God, we command our sickness to come out. For the Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 1 to 14, that the dry bone shall come back to life. Every dry bone in your life, let them begin to come back to life right now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Exodus chapter 15, verse 26 says that I am Jehovah Rapha who healeth your diseases. Therefore, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, receive your healing now. Receive your healing now. Let whoever that is sick receive the wind of healing now. Receive the wind of healing now. Receive it in the name of Jesus. Come out, you spirit of sickness, you demon of sickness, you gullet of sickness, you lion of sickness. I command you now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Come out. Let there be peace in your life. May God bless you and keep you and strengthen you, give you favor and testimonies. May you claim your provisions in Jesus. And may your mountains melt by the power of the Holy Ghost. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.